Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this session of LV systolic function evaluation. We have with us Dr. Sanjay Mittal, an ace cardiologist based at Medanta MedCity at Gurgaon, a devoted non-visive person looking after heart failure program in cardiology section of Medanta. He is with us since the onset of these training programs, and he's been taking this topic regularly for the last more than 20 years now. Very good friend of mine, very hardworking, devoted cardiologist who looks after the benefit of patients the best of his capabilities. With these few words, let me hand over the mic to Dr. Sanjay Mittal for taking his talk on LV systolic function evaluation for this particular batch of 44th comprehensive course on echocardiography. Dr. Mittal, thank you very much. It's all yours. You can unmute yourself. You are muted right now. Now you can mute yourself.
Okay. Thank you. I could understand this was a strategy to just not allow to me to speak.
No, not you. Let the other people should not disturb in between.
I know. Thanks, Dr. Rakesh. I think this was thanks for everything you have done so far for the worth of echocardiography and the awareness and the knowledge of echocardiography in the country. And I would say that what topic I'm going to cover today is of utmost importance for all the practicing cardiologists. Because whatever anybody may say, we are still dependent upon left ventricular systolic dysfunction for assessment of cardiac physiology and therapies. And till this day, we have a reduced ejection fraction and preserved ejection fraction division in heart failure and the treatments. So I'm going to cover this topic today in the next half an hour, 45 minutes, about the systolic function evaluation on echocardiography for a person who presents to us for cardiac evaluation. And three things we have to focus: the concept of wall motion abnormalities, that is regional systolic functions, evaluation of global left ventricular systolic functions, and the basis of strain, because that is something which is upcoming, and possibly by the time all of us practicing cardiologists would go into clinical practice, we would recognize that all the echo machines have strain capabilities and the ramifications out of it. So let me focus first on the regional systolic functions, and I'm going to focus on the right left ventricle. So if this cartoon you see, and these are coronary arteries, and you can imagine this is the left anterior descending artery, the backside artery is circumflex artery. If there is a lesion here, there would be cessation of blood supply to this particular territory, which is supplied by the LAD. The remaining coronary artery territories supply adequate blood, and that is not going to cause any flow heterogeneity. So as soon as the flow heterogeneity arises, there are certain cascade of events which start. The first thing is that there are metabolic alterations, that there is lack of oxygen, lack of metabolism, decreased energy levels, which would lead to certain alterations, which can be detected at the level of PET scan or CS sampling. Then we have diastolic dysfunction, because even the relaxation of the myocardium is an energy-rich activity, and diastolic dysfunction onset is there. But the most important of them is the dyssynergy, which is systolic dysfunction, which originates after the heterogeneity, flow heterogeneity continues for a few minutes. And this thing then leads to the pain, which is the tip of the iceberg. So people may have ischemia even if they do not have symptoms of angina or even STT changes. And that is the beauty of echocardiogram. It picks up wall motion abnormalities much earlier than the ECG or clinical symptoms come. So if you look at this diagram here, this echocardiogram, this is apical four-chamber view. you can look at the left ventricle and anybody can imagine that this portion of the ventricle is not contracting at all. Whereas the basal portion of the left ventricle towards the mitral annulus is contracting reasonably well. And this is what we call as segmental wall motion abnormality, which means this particular apical segments of the myocardium are not contracting, but the basal portion is contracting. For all practical purposes, if we have heterogeneity of this nature, that means certain segments are not contracting as much as the remaining segments are, this is a hallmark of ischemia. That means there's a lack of blood supply there somewhere or the other. Well, there are certain situations where even patchy myocarditis or certain other diseases can produce segmental wall motion abnormalities, but they usually have a peculiarity, and I'll discuss those things as we go ahead and explain things to you guys. And it is very important for diagnosis of coronary artery disease, whether it is in association with some other abnormalities. Say, for example, a person comes to us for evaluation of mitral valve disease or aortic disease or ASD or whatever, and we find wall motion abnormalities of this nature, that means he has concomitant coronary artery disease and should be excluded or ruled out. And this is also mandatory because if you imagine 70% of all burden of the cardiovascular diseases today presenting to a cardiology clinic is coronary artery disease. And this is something which is very important for all of us to understand and evaluate rightly. So let's go to how do we systematically evaluate the wall motion abnormalities. There are certain things which I'm going to elaborate, but there are the whole of the left ventricle. This is a bullseye plot. Instead of looking at the left ventricle like this longitudinal, it is looking at the left ventricle like this, the basal segments, the middle segments, and the apical segments. And everything has been plotted as a bullseye. So if you have a 16-segment scoring system, which is the most commonly used, conventionally used technique for the echocardiographic assessment, and even my preference is the same because it is very easy, and I've been trained and I've been doing this thing day in and day out for last so many decades now. However, when we are looking at perfusion studies, then we look at the 17-segment scoring system, where the apex, the 17th segment is the center. If you can look at this particular center of the bullseye plot, this is the apex, the tip of the apex, which forms the 17th segment. The rest of the segments, 16 segments, remain identically the same as they were described in the 16-segment scoring system. I'll come back to you guys and describe how do we reach to that 16-segment scoring system. But there are 16, this is 17, and this 18-segment scoring system, where every part, apex is divided into six, the middle portion is divided into six, and basal portion is divided into six. This is something which is used by machines because they don't have that much intelligence as to dissect out the apical four and the tip of the apex is 17th segment. All the machine-driven programs, whether it is speckle tracking system or it is MRI or it is a thallium scan, they use the 18-segment scoring systems. But for us echocardiographers, clinical echocardiographers, we use the 16-segment scoring system. And let's discuss those 16-segment scoring system and understand that a little bit more. So this center picture, if you look at, is the parasternal long axis view. We have a rim of the right ventricle. The right ventricle is here, the right ventricle free wall, and the left ventricle, which is a circular nature. We see the two papillary muscles here. And according to the positioning of the transducer, which is here, anterior portion, there is the anterior portion of the interventricular septum. Well, this is the septum, complete septum, but the anterior portion and the posterior portion. The posterior septum is not called as posterior septum, but it's just the septum. So there is anterior septum, there is anterior wall, there is lateral wall, which gives rise to the papillary muscle. There is a posterior wall, and there is inferior wall, which again gives rise to the papillary muscle. And there is then the septum. You can call it inferior septum, posterior, but better to call it only septum, and I'll tell you why. because septum, this portion is not reaching to the apex as anterior or posterior. So at the apex portion, it is just the septum. And that is why it is preferred to call every segment of this particular segment as septum rather than posterior septum. So if you have a transducer in the anterior portion and you have the transducer cutting the plane of the ventricle like this. So this translates into parasternal long axis view, right? The transducer is anteriorly, it is cutting the left ventricle and right ventricle just in this particular axis, if you can look at it. So it would cut the right ventricular outflow tract, a portion of the right ventricular free wall. You can see here, this is the right ventricular free wall, the right ventricular outflow tract. This is the portion of the right ventricular outflow tract. Then it cuts through the anterior septum, which is this portion, which we see the difference between the RV and the LV is anterior septum, not the septum. It should be ranked as always anterior septum. So in parasternal long axis view, we look at the anterior septum and then the posterior wall. This is the posterior wall. So parasternal long axis view, we look at RVOT, right ventricular free wall according to that, anterior septum and the posterior septum. And this is divided into, because it does not reach the apex, it is divided into the basal portion and the mid portion. And same way, the posterior wall is basal portion, which is close to the mitral annulus, and the mid portion, which is at the level of papillary muscles. Mind it, the posterior wall is not giving rise to any papillary muscle, either the posterior inferior or anterolateral. So that is why you don't see the origin of papillary muscle in parasternal long axis. Next, if we cut the ventricle, we move to the apex and look at the transducer pointing towards the left, right shoulder. Then we cut the ventricle in this particular fashion, which would mean there would be right ventricular free wall here. You can see the right ventricular free wall. Then there would be right ventricular cavity. There would be the septum. So here in the four chamber view, you look at the septum, which is usually the inferior posterior portion of the septum rather than the anterior septum. Anterior septum is in the parasternal long axis view. And thereafter, it is the lateral wall, which gives rise to the origin of anterolateral papillary muscle. So in four chamber view, you'll see the anterolateral papillary muscle origin in the mid portion and the lateral wall. So four chamber view shows us right ventricle free wall, but septum and the lateral wall. Lateral wall giving rise to the mid portion of the papillary muscle, anterolateral papillary muscle. And the whole ventricle is thereafter divided into three equal parts. Basal third, which is near the mitral valve annulus, is basal portion. Mid portion, middle third, which is giving rise to the papillary muscle here. And the apical third, which is giving rise, which is towards the tip of the apex. And we have apical septum, mid septum and basal septum, basal lateral, mid lateral giving rise to the papillary muscle and the apical lateral wall. Next, if we'll cut the ventricle in such a way that the right ventricle is not seen, and this makes a two chamber view. And this two chamber view would be by rotation about 60 degrees of the transducer at the apex. And this cuts the ventricle in through the anterior wall. So this would be the anterior wall. If you look at the two chamber view, this is the anterior wall and this is the inferior wall, which gives rise to this papillary muscle bulge, which is posterior inferior papillary muscle. So in apical two chamber view, we'll see the inferior wall and the anterior wall. And mind it, these are again divided into three parts reaching to the apex, the basal inferior and basal anterior, basal inferior, basal anterior, mid portion, which gives rise to the papillary muscle, which is mid inferior and mid anterior, and the apical inferior and apical anterior walls in the two chamber view. So this is how we can translate the short axis view or the, all the segments into the various views. Long axis view shows mid and basal anterior septum, mid and basal posterior wall, that is four segments. Apical four chamber view shows us the septum, the basal, mid and apical, and lateral wall, basal, mid and apical lateral wall, that means six segments. And the two chamber view again shows us the six segments, the basal, mid and apical inferior, basal, mid, and apical anterior wall. So 6 plus 6 plus 4. This makes the total count of 16. If you look at the tip of the apex here, this portion, which would make the 17th segment, which is sometimes used for perfusion studies. So let's look at why is it important to have the understanding of the definition of these segments. So this is the cartoon or diagrammatic representation of the short axis, apical four-chamber view, which shows the septum, lateral wall, as I said, one-third, one-third, and one-third. The apical two-chamber view, again, showing the basal, mid, and apical inferior, apical, mid, and basal anterior wall. And the long axis view showing us the basal and mid anterior septum and basal and mid posterior wall. So the importance is to understand the usual definition in accordance to the coronary distribution. So if you look at the LAD, LAD runs in the anterior interventricular group and winds around the apex. So it runs in the groove between the right ventricle and the left ventricle interventricular groove. And it runs from the base, winding around the apex. This is the usual distribution. And obviously, it would distribute all the segments in accordance to that. The anterior septum all the way through, anterior wall all the way through. And as it is winding around the apex, all the segments by the apex. Whether you call it 17th segment or the 16th segment, the whole apex is usually supplied by the LAD until unless it is just type 1, not reaching to the apex, which is rare. So we would have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 segments. If we have 16 segment scoring system, that means about 50% of myocardium is supplied by the LAD. And if you have the 17th segment added, that means about 9 segments out of the 17 segments will be supplied by the LAD. So it's the biggest artery territory for the left ventricle. And what also is important is it can also distinguish whether the lesion is at the base of the LAD, mid LAD, or apex. If the distal LAD is involved, only the apical segments or maybe the distal mone segments of the myocardium would be involved. And if the mid segment are involved, then sometimes the mid anterior wall or mid anterior septum may be involved. And the proximal LAD, sometimes rarely the basal anterior wall and basal anterior septum may also be involved. So you can not only just detect whether it is LAD, but also sometimes pick out where in the LAD the lesion might be, depending upon the territory or abnormal territory contractions. Let's look at the other artery. The other artery is circumflex. The circumflex runs in the AV groove from anterior side to the posterior side, and sometimes reaching the crux and giving the posterior descending artery as well. But majorly, it does not reach to the apex, the crux, and only supplies the lateral and the posterior walls. Obviously, going from anterior posterior wall, the proximal OMs would be supplying the lateral wall, and distal OMs would be supplying the posterior wall. So it supplies the lateral wall, basal and mid, and it supplies the posterior and basal and posterior mid portion. So in the parasternal long axis view, we have circumflex territory here and the LAD territory here. And in four-chamber view, we have the lateral wall, which is supplied usually by the proximal circumflex artery. Let's look at the RCA. It usually supplies the posterior descending artery and PLVs, supplying again the adjacent area, which is the basal and mid septum and basal and mid inferior wall. Well, there are a lot of great distributions, and the arteries are so much different in different individuals. So there are watershed zones here, or the borderline areas, which always create a confusion. But the umbras or the dense areas are this, which is usually the PDA and should not be ignored in that particular fashion. So if you look at the four-chamber view, it gives you a distribution of all three arteries. That means the right coronary in the form of PDA, the apex is supplied by the LAD, and the lateral wall is supplied by proximal LCX. So this is one of the views which gives you the information about possibly involvement of all three arteries. As I was mentioning about the bull's eye plot, if we superimpose the basal at the level of mitral valve, left ventricular short axis, at the level of papillary muscle short axis, and at the level of apex in totality together, we can create a bull's eye plot. So the bull's eye plot is where we have, and this is called as anterior wall, this is anterior septum, and the LED is running in between them, although winding around the apex, giving septals to supply the anterior septum, and the diagonals to supply the anterior wall and the towards the apex. And the distal LED supplies the whole of the apex. Circumflex runs in AV groove, supplying the OMs, the first OM and the second OM sometimes supplies the lateral wall from the base to the mid portion. And then the distal circumflex, the terminal OMs supplying the posterior walls in that particular portion. The PDA supplies the septum basal and the mid basal area, and the PLBs from the right coronary supplies the inferior wall. If the circumflex is big enough, it is taking over the inferior wall, then the inferior wall also may be supplied by the circumflex. So that is why I was saying that there may be patient to patient individual variations, but usually in a common picture, more than 50% of times, this is the picture which we'll find. So after identifying the wall motion and the segments, and also how many segments are involved, the next question to be answered is how serious or severe is the wall motion abnormality. So if you look at normal segments, there is a situation when the diastolic thickness increases by 50% to cause a systolic thickness. So diastolic thickness, if it is 1 centimeter or 10 millimeter, it becomes 1.5 centimeters in systole. That is usually a normal segment. Hypokinesis is when the contractility or systolic thickening is 20 to 50%. That means from 1 centimeter, that is 10 millimeters, it becomes either 120 millimeters or, 12 millimeters or 15 millimeters. 1.2 centimeters to 1.5 centimeters. Akinesis is when the thickening in systole is less than 20%, that means 10% or so. That means from 1 centimeter, it becomes 1.1 centimeter or so. Dyskinesis is instead of thickening, there is a thinning in systole. And that is what is called a dyskinesis. Aneurysm is when the systolic thickness as well as diastolic thickness both are reduced. That means the segment is thinned out even in diastole, then it is called as an aneurysm. And although these points can be given a value, a score of increasing order in the amount of the dysfunction. That means normal is 1, and as we go up, 2 is hypokinesis, 3 is akinesis, 4 is dyskinesis, and 5 is when even the diastolic thickness is reduced and it is an aneurysm which is deformed in diastole. This is the theoretical definition, but what is the practical part? The practical part is normal is your awareness. You have been seeing hundreds and hundreds of echocardiogram, and you come to know what is normal contractility like. Hypokinesis is when some of the segments, just one I showed you, there were segments which are contracting really well, and there was another segment which was not contracting at all. However, if that segment was seen to contract, but not as much as the rest of the segments, that is called as hypokinesia. Akinesia is when, despite your best efforts, your eyes don't perceive the thickening change in systole, because your eyes are not tuned to perceive less than 20% thickening as perceptible. And that is why anything less than 20% thickening is called as akinesia. That means there is no perceptible change in systole from the diastolic thickness. And when there is an outpouching of a particular segment during systole, but the diastolic contour is maintained, this is called as dyskinesis. And if the diastolic outpouching, there is an outpouching diastole also, and which worsens in systole, this is called as aneurysm. So these are the practical terms, and these are the rankings of the score. So worse the score, higher the score versus the wall motion abnormalities, and bad is the prognosis. And also, if we can sometimes amalgamate all the 16 segments, we have 16 segments, and if all the 16 segments are normal, they get a score of 1 each. That means total score is 16 divided by number of segments, 16, the total index becomes 1. However, if suppose 5 segments are akinetic, that means 5 threes are 15 are akinetic, 15 plus the rest of the 11 segments, 15 plus 11 is 26. 26 divided by 16, that means the index would thereafter become about 1.8. So this means the worse, the higher the index, the worse is the total wall motion abnormality index and worse is the prognosis. So at the end of the day, we should not just be satisfied that we have detected wall motion abnormalities. There should be just not that attitude. We should look at the severity, whether the akinesia, dyskinesia, or aneurysms are there, because as we go ahead, higher the number versus the prognosis, because it signifies lesser amount of surviving myocardium in that particular segment thickness. So that means whether there is scarring or not, because scarring would mean that that particular area is not as echogenic as the myocardium is, rather it becomes more white. That means more echo refractive as compared to the normal myocardium, because that has less water. We should be able to pick out which vascular territory is this, LAD, circumflex, or RCA, or how many vessels are involved. All these things should come out with a good report of assessment of wall motion abnormality. Let's go to some examples. Well, you'll read, because this is non-interactive webinar, so you'll read out it with me. This is a parasternal long axis view. This segment is basal anterior septum. This one is mid-anterior septum. The contractility is good because you can see during systole, there's a good contractility. This segment is basal posterior, and this one is mid-posterior. This is the papillary muscle, which sometimes come into the view, but if you look out of the papillary muscle view, you can see all this segment is absolutely akinetic, thinned out. This is scarred posterior wall, which means this is a likelihood of having circumflex territory as infarct. The LAD territory seems to be doing fine in this particular patient. The same patient having a four-chamber view, you can look at the basal septum, which is the right corneal PDA territory. That means this patient has a normal PDA territory. The mid and septum is okay. Apical septum is okay. Apical lateral, I can't see properly, but at least the mid lateral is absolutely infarcted. So this means, as I was mentioning, the lateral wall is proximal LCX. This patient is likely to be having circumflex territory infarct, which is because of a proximal circumflex lesion. If you look at the two-chamber view, the inferior wall is perfectly fine. That means the right coronary artery territory is perfectly okay. And the LAD territory is preserved in thickness, although hypokinetic, which means this person might also be having a LAD lesion, which is not infarcted, but hypokinesia means surviving muscle is there. Another case, this patient is a complete paradox. You have, again, a parasternal long axis view, basal anterior septum. Definitely, this is normal. But that's what I was mentioning. In this particular view, you can see the posterior wall, the basal and mid, they're contracting extremely good. This is normal segment. Compared to this segment, this is contracting. The basal anterior septum is contracting, but it is not contracting as much as the posterior wall. So this is hypokinetic. If you look at the mid anterior septum, I don't see, you forget about this particular segment and just look at the mid anterior septum. And I don't see any change in thickness in this mid anterior septum. This is akinetic. So this means this is likely to be LAD. And where in the LAD? Because the basal anterior septum is supplied by the proximal, the first septal branch, So this patient is likely to have a proximal LAD lesion. So that's how we can not only detect the wall motion abnormalities, but also predict which was possibly involved. There are certain other catches. Let's go ahead with this particular description. In this particular fashion, just focus on the mid anterior septum. Do you think this is hypokinetic? Do you think this is normokinetic? Or do you think this is akinetic? I'll give you 10 seconds just to make comments. Do you think this segment is akinetic, hypokinetic, or normokinetic? So the thing is, if you look at the basal anterior septum, there's no doubt this is contracting reasonably well. And this thing is definitely moving inwards. So, but it does not seem to be moving or contracting as much as the basal segment. So definitely there is some wall motion normality. Some people may say hypokinetic, but my question to you is just look at the segment again and do you perceive any change in thickness? Just eliminate the interference of the basal anterior septum from your assessment. Once you do that, there is no change in thickness. So these are very common problems because akinetic segments may be dead, but hypokinetic segments means there is a good 70-80% myocardium alive in that particular segment. And that means revascularization or improvement can be expected in those particular segments. So that is why these are very common things. When there is an adjacent segment, which is hypercontractile, it pulls the adjacent, this akinetic segments along with it, and a passive movement is there, which is no thickening, but only movement. And this is what we call as a pull effect, because the hyperkinetic segment is pulling these segments and it's just creating a false movement, but no thickening. These are important, and especially when the heart rate is high, a lot of times these kind of a thing can happen. Okay, this is another example. If you look at these segments are all contracting well, and septum may be lagging behind. So this seems to be hypokinetic segment, but actually looking at it, it's not. If you look at the complete cardiac cycle, this segment starts contracting early. And when it is starting to contract, the rest of the segments are not contracting. But when the rest of the segments start contracting, this lags behind. This is a very common thing which we find in left bundle branch block, because the excitation of the septum happens earlier and lateral wall and the posterior wall happens later. So when the major chunk of the myocardium is contracting, this septum segment seems to be lagging behind and sometimes ranked wrongly as hypokinetic. But if you look at the thickening again, this would not happen because this is what we call as, again, there is thickening, but movement is diminished because of lag of the phase. And very commonly in left bundle branch block or WPW, right-sided pathways, or in right ventricular pacing as well, the same thing can happen. We have to be very watchful in these situations. Okay, let's look at this. It would have been wonderful if we had had interactions. This is a parastin long axis view, right? And this segment is anterior septum, basal and mid. We all know that. This one is basal, posterior. What happens in a parastin long axis? Posterior wall, right? So this is basal, posterior, and this one is mid, again, posterior. All right. Here, this is a four-chamber view. We have the lateral wall, basal, mid, showing the papillary muscle and apical lateral, apical septum, mid septum, and basal septum. Many times we create that kind of a mistake because this is not so. If you look at the papillary muscle, the mid posterior wall should not have given the origin of papillary muscle. And here is the time that we realize that landmark should be assessed, and this kind of papillary muscle should be arising from inferior wall, mid inferior wall. So this view is showing mid inferior segment, not mid posterior. And there may be a difference of coronary arteries that mid inferior wall is supplied by the RCA as compared to the mid posterior, which is usually supplied by circumflex. So the cross coronary circulation can be wrongly assessed here. If you look at this particular chamber, this is the aortic valve, which is opening. And this five chamber view or almost a four and a half chamber view would mean that this portion is anterior portion of the interventricular septum and not the septum. So this is instead of the RCA territory turns out to be the proximal LAD segment. And these kind of problems may arise. We have to be very cautious throughout the cardiac cycle, systole and diastole, because the heart is constantly moving and twisting. We should be cautious which segment are we looking at in diastole and which segment are we looking at in systole. So if there are some problems of views, images, we can't see the good parasympathetic long axis view, we can look at the short axis view and all the three views or the base, the apex, mid and proximal or basal portions, and all 16 segments can easily be analyzed in those particular territories. Okay, another confusion. This is a four chamber view, right? The right left atrium, right ventricle, and the left ventricle. The basal lateral is fine, mid lateral is fine, apical lateral is hypocontractile, apical septum is hypocontractile, mid and basal septum seems to be fine. Ejection fraction in this patient seems to be around 45-ish, right? Only this particular segment may be lagging behind or hypokinetic. In contrast, I have another four-chamber view. This is the right atrium, left atrium, right ventricle contracting reasonably well. The basal septum is fine. Mid septum is hypokinetic. Apical septum is akinetic, rather dyskinetic. Basal lateral is fine. Mid lateral is hypokinetic. And apical lateral is akinetic. The ejection fraction here, it presumably is going to be just maximum 25%. Would you imagine these two images are of the same patient and just taken 4 or 5 seconds, not minutes, seconds apart, just for the sake of this description to you guys? This is the same patient as this one. Here, a person would be ranked as an ejection fraction of 45, and here, the ejection fraction would be 20-25%. With a significant serious wall motion abnormalities, here hardly anything. This is called as foreshortening. This is the same patient in the foreshortening. And what is foreshortening is going to be evident by this particular thing. If you look at the transducer position in this two chamber view is at this particular point. And the left ventricle apex is totally out of bound. If you cut the ventricle like this, which is happening here, this is only looking at the four chamber view in this particular fashion, not looking at the apex at all. And this kind of problem very commonly happens because we usually start our examination and parasympathetic long axis view and then go to the apex and look at the right shoulder and look at the four chamber view. The mistake we do is we start moving out and look at the four chamber. As soon as we get the four chamber, we are fine. That's the wrong thing. Because we should keep on, because we have to understand apex is the outermost, lowermost portion of the left ventricle. So we have to keep on going out and down till the time we lose the heart and then come back in, and we would not commit such kind of mistake. Otherwise, we can easily make 25%, 45% without any intervention. I mean, and that's a crime. We should be very watchful of this thing. So foreshortening is something which we have to be watching for. Again, don't be ever perturbed by finding such kind of images. We can't see the endocardium here. And if you can't see the endocardium here, refrain from commenting upon the wall motion abnormalities. Such kind of thing can happen because of calcification or fibrosis in the septum because of the previous infarctions. And it is always better to say can't see or see in some other views. And this view also, I can't see anything in the lateral wall. Please don't comment on wall motion abnormality in such kind of views because you can do wrong to the patient. If, even if you say poor window, no problems. 5 to 10% of patients, despite the best echocardiographers, can still have wrong windows. they can improve their endocardial delineation by contrast injection or transesophageal echocardiograms, or sometimes even MRIs to look at the wall muscle abnormalities and comment on those things rather than doing it wrong. So I would say have courage to report, but not be visualized. And there's no shortcut to experience. That is something which is very important to understand. Mind it, another thing about the wall motion abnormalities is wall motion abnormalities can show us ischemia or infarction, but it cannot be diagnostic of ongoing ischemia or not. So ongoing heart attacks or not. So the thrombolysis is not based on wall motion abnormalities. There has to be ECG changes. You can take a decision on your clinical grounds along with echocardiogram to push the patient to the angio table, but not for thrombolysis. So a few quick words about the global left ventricular systolic functions. Mainly, very commonly, we do M-mode echocardiogram, Tikolo's method, to look at the LV ejection fraction, which is absurd, wrong. It should not be done. The only thing is you can have M-mode, off-axis M-mode, which can be done in many of the machines instead of like this in off-axis, and get a proper M-mode and do it. But yet it is a three-dimensional motion and three-dimensional heart, and you are looking at just one dimensions, you are bound to make errors, and I would never ever encourage doing so. Better is a modified Simpson's method, where you look at the four chamber and two chamber views. The whole ventricle is divided into 20 discs of similar lengths, similar thicknesses, and it is summated to give you volumes in diastole and systole, and then we calculate the ejection fraction. And this is a classical example. Be very watchful of delineating the proper endocardium. Unfortunately, if you don't see the endocardium well, no way you can give a good ejection fraction by Simpsons. So if you could see the endocardium, trace it out. It gives you a 20 discs here, summates the volume in diastole and systole, and gives you ejection fraction, which is obviously everybody knows is end diastolic volume minus end systolic volume divided by end diastolic volume. Or you can say stroke volume divided by end diastolic volume. So a couple of things, important things we have to look at. Always have ECG gating. That is very important when we look at the modified Simpson's assessment. And both of end diastole as well as end systole. Mind it, at both the times, both mitral and aortic valve should be closed. In end diastole, that means the diastolic ventricular filling is complete only when the mitral valve closes, but aortic valve has not opened. So closed, but not open. This is isometric systole, right? Contraction time. And that is when you have to look at it. And end systole means the ventricle has contracting, the aortic valve was open, and now it closes, but the mitral valve does not open. So this means it's isovolumetric relaxation time, isometric relaxation. That is the time when you look at end systole. So these are both the times both valves should be closed. And mind it, we also say, again, experience has no shortcut, because most of the experienced echocardiographers do not need volumetric assessment because they can do the eyeballing and give you an ejection fraction. For us, as beginners, the 3D echocardiogram may be a good way to correlate with MRIs and the reproducibility. And it is unfortunate that a lot of machines don't have it, and you need to have a different training of it. The last part of my talk is going to be next couple of minutes describing about the strain and the strain regimen. The ventricle is a complex left ventricle. The muscle fibers actually make it so complex that there are a lot of movements happening. There is if the left ventricle is like this long, there is shortening of the left ventricle long axis. There is contraction, we all know, of the circumference. And there is thickening. The muscle is thickening. But besides that, there is a writhing effect. That means the apex contracts clockwise, moves clockwise, and the base. So it's just like writhing movement, which is also happening. So all these movements have now been assessed. There are differences that there is longitudinal shortening, there is circumferential shortening, and there is radial thickening. So all these changes can now be detected by watching the speckles. And what are the speckles? Today, just like a fingerprint, you know, you have fingerprints, and all those fingerprint sensors can actually detect one person from the other. Same technology is being utilized by all these machines. The whole myocardium you show to the machine, it actually tracks the speckles in this thing and then forms a fingerprint of that particular segment. And during the cardiac cycle, the diastole and systole, it checks the changes in the distance of these speckles. And by that, it creates a shortening and long lengthening assessment. Wherever there is shortening, that means the distance between two speckles is reducing. And this means this the strain is negative. That means the shortening is there. And wherever there is increase in distance, that means this speckle is increased and there is increase in the strain. So if you look at when systole happens, the length of the left ventricle reduces. So the longitudinal strain would decrease in systole. The circumference reduces. So the circumference reduces, that means the circumferential strain would reduce. Minus, and the thickness increases, so the radial strain would increase. It is a positive value. So that is something which we can imagine and do in our clinical practice. Machines require certain inputs. So they require an image, they track the speckles, and then you trace out the endocardium or the region of interest in them. And thereafter, they track the whole cardiac cycle in accordance to their intelligence and plot a graph that in diastole and systole, how the things are happening, the strain is changing. And this is also plotted as an M mode. All these segments can be seen. You can see the apical contraction happens a little earlier at the basal. And this is something which is happening in a normal person. Same thing can be plotted in a bullseye plot. These are, again, as I said, 17th segment, the center, minus 22. Normal strain, longitudinal strain is minus 20 or lower. Why I'm saying lower is any digit value of minus 22 is lower than minus 20. It's a negative value. So that is why minus 22 is lower than minus 20. Don't get confused about it. Minus 26 is lower than minus 20. But minus 13 is higher than minus 20. And that is why if the values in digit numerables is lesser or the value is, okay, don't confuse it, sir. If the digit value is lesser than 20, it is impaired. However, if it is lesser than 16, it is definitely a defect. 16 to 18 is a borderline area, where machine to machine and individual to individual, there could be discrepancies. So all these 17 segments can be analyzed. You can see the septum and the inferior wall and the lateral and posterior wall segments are showing definite decrease in the contractility, suggesting that this is a circumflex or an RC territory defect. We are mostly focused on the global longitudinal strain as of now because it is reproducible. Their normal range is well-defined as I described to you, minus 20. Prognostic value is established. The lower the value or the digit value of the GLS versus the prognosis. But unfortunately, there were a lot of vendor-dependent things. The Philips guys were different. All the machines were giving a different values. However, there is now quite a bit of agreement in the values, and those kind of discrepancies have been eliminated. So let me just show end you with this showcase. This is an image of a patient who presented to us with angina. And we did an exercise echocardiogram, and you can imagine that there was hardly any contractile abnormality in peak systole during this patient. This is the two-chamber view. Apex is contracting well. The basal segments are contracting well. There, the four-chamber view again, the long axis view again, everything was fine. But when we did a GLS, we could see a subtle drop in contractility at the apex. So the longitudinal strain dropping down is an important sign of value addition when we do a stress testing. And this is sometimes, which is in good labs, we are routinely doing. So ladies and gentlemen, what is happening here as far as strain rate imaging is concerned, it helps us in detection of ischemia, especially the longitudinal strain. Acute coronary syndrome also, but unfortunately, the data is emerging out of it. And also the most important thing is a prognostic marker. If the GLS overall is a lower value, then it is a worse prognostic sign. And all these things are something which are developing, and soon we'll find them into the guidelines. Thank you. Now I'm here to answer questions. If you have, you must have questions. I'm here. You can have, I'm stopping the sharing of the slides and waiting for you two guys to ask me questions. You can unmute and then ask questions.
Good evening, sir. I have a question.
Yes, please, Manoj.
So in case of dilated cardiomyopathy, already there is a thinning of the myocardium. And if the patient develop MI, then how can we know that there is wall motion abnormality or not?
Excellent, excellent question. You know, the dilated cardiomyopathy is a disease when the myocardium may be thinned out, not necessarily so, but it may be thinned out. So again, the principles remain the same, that you would have abnormality of a particular segments out of proportion to remaining segments. So if suppose LAD territory was involved, the apex is the first thing to go, and that becomes akinetic. The basal segments may be still hypokinetic. So there is a relative wall motion abnormality. Mind it, sometimes dilated cardiomyopathy may be the result of patchy myocarditis, where certain segments which do not bide by the coronary distribution may show wall motion abnormalities, maybe akinesia or whatever. Remaining segments may be normal. But if you look at a distribution of coronary, according to the coronary distribution, they don't obey those laws. Say, for example, basal septum would be involved and basal anterior septum also would be involved. So basal septum is the RCA, basal anterior septum is the LAD, the first septal, and the apex is spare. So if the proximal LAD was involved, the apex is first one to go. The basal segments are the last one to go. But if the basal segments are involved and apex is spared, it's likely to be a patchy myocarditis. So that kind of a picture may also be there. So that's a very good question. But if you have generalized hypokinesia, the important dictum is we wrongly diagnose dilated cardiomyopathy without excluding coronary artery disease. Many of patients who have come to my clinical practice, because I run the heart failure clinic, they come with a presumptive diagnosis of dilated cardiomyopathy and at the age of 40, 35, 40, 45 years. And when we look at the angiogram, because that's a correctable cause of heart failure, we find that they have severe triple vessel disease, and we have done bypasses in many of them, and they have, lo behold, improved like anything. So just ranking dilated cardiomyopathy because of global wall motion abnormality may also be a coronary artery disease sometimes, because of the fact that all three arteries are equally involved and there is a global hypokinesia.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I also have a doubt that triple vessel disease is involvement of RCA, LCX or LAD, or sir, involvement of LAD, LCX or diaconal?
No. Because diagonal is a part of the LAD, right? So we see triple vessel disease, we call when the all three arteries territories are involved, right? The circumflex as well as the LAD. Confusion may be with the intermedius, because when the first diagonal branch or first OM, obtuse marginal branch, is the first branch of the circumflex, and diagonal is the first branch of the LAD. Sometimes they can arise so proximal that when you have a bifurcation, the circumflex and the LAD, the intermedius just comes like this. So
yes, sir.
Whether this is a branch of the circumflex or is it the first diagonal, which is originating earlier, is very difficult to say. So that is sometimes we call as four vessel disease.
Okay, sir. Sir, the treatment of that triple vessel disease always bypass surgery?
No, not necessarily. Because in many situations, we look at revascularization. In my clinical practice, what I look at revascularization is where there is scar or dead area, there is no point of revascularization in that particular territory. If the ejection fraction is too low, the surgical risks of bypass also goes up. So many a times when there is a life-threatening situation and the surgical risk is coming out to be very high, we may do angioplasty or targeted angioplasty to one or two or sometimes even three vessels. But that is dependent upon the relative risk assessment by the surgeons and by the interventionist. Sometimes they have comorbidities which prevent them to get a bypass surgery. So that is something also, and there are few people who say, I'll die, but I am not going to get a bypass surgery, especially the Japanese.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
But the data, recent data, just last month, the data has come up, which is very clearly showing that for triple vessel disease, even FFR guided angioplasty had suboptimal results. It was not even touching the non-inferiority. So that was a non-inferiority trial, which showed that the bypass surgery was better than angioplasty. So first option should be surgery. Only if the surgery is very high risk, just like we do TAVR, you know, transcutaneous aortic valve replacements. TAVR is offered for people who are very high risk for a surgical treatment. Only then we offer TAVR. Same for triple vessel bypass revascularization.
Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Yes, Dr.
जी सर, मैं पूछा हाइपरकाइनेटिक कंडीशंस में सर, हाइपरडायनेमिक कंडीशंस में सर, इजेक्शन फ्रैक्शन कैलकुलेट करना थोड़ा टफ होता है, वो कैसे करेंगे?
नहीं, कैलकुलेट करना में प्रिंसिपल्स वही रहेंगे. आपका हाइपरडायनेमिक सर्कुलेशन में आपको एंडस्टोलिक वॉल्यूम और एंडसिस्टोलिक वॉल्यूम ही लेना है. व्हाट यू कैन कम आउट विद इज एन इजेक्शन फ्रैक्शन टू द रेंज ऑफ 75-80, समटाइम 85, समटाइम्स इवन 90%. But that is hyperdynamic circulation. That means the end diastolic volume is higher and end systolic volume is smaller and stroke volume is very high. So that is hyperdynamic circulation. But if you wanted to assess that there is hypercontractile segments in the basal segments and akinetic at the apex, then the difficulty, if you go by the modified Simpson's rule, this is the way to do, because it takes care of the regional wall motion abnormalities and gives you a legitimate value of ejection fraction. So it's very much doable. And more important, when you have regional wall motion abnormality, that means there are segments where hypercontractile and there are segments which are not contracting.
Ji sir, thank you.
Dr. Isha, you have questions?
No, sir. Yeah. No question.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Shamshad, go ahead.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, what observation we get in a patient having old MI, having re-infarctions, I mean, a patient having already inferior wall MI and developed anterior wall MI. So, that's in echo, what observation we'll get?
Wonderful. So, if, as I understand your question, if the person has had inferior wall MI in the past and now presents with anterior wall myocardial infarction. So, old MI and fresh MI can be distinguished on echocardiogram by presence of scar. And the scar is defined when the muscle is thinned out and it more fibrotic. As I said, the normal myocardium is more water, has more water, and fibrous tissue has less water. So when the echo beam comes and strikes a myocardium, you'll see a spongy or a kind of a echolucent muscle. It's a classical muscle mass. Whereas when it is fibrotic, in a few of the examples I did show you that the segment, complete segment was more fibrotic and more refringent. Everything was passing. It's more white, if you can call it. So if you have a thinned out segment with more whiteness, this is significant of old, early infarct. And when there is akinetic segment, or wall motion abnormality with preserved myocardial nature. That means that is not showing fibrosis or thinning. It's a fresh infarct or ischemia. Unfortunately, echocardiogram cannot differentiate between a recent infarct or recent ischemia. Ischemia or infarct, it cannot differentiate. So an akinetic segment may be dead, that means infarcted, or ischemic, that means alive. That is why hibernation is actually something which we evaluate by giving dobutamine. When we give dobutamine, the akinetic segment, which was normal in thickness, but it was not seemingly contracting, when we give low dose dobutamine, the contractility increases. We can see that segment from akinesia to become hypokinetic or sometimes even normokinetic. Whereas an infarcted segment would not increase that contractility. So that is how we differentiate between akinetic segment, which is infarcted, versus hibernating, that is ischemic. The old and fresh infarct is basically differentiated on the basis of thinning out and scarring, which is in the form of fibrosis or sometimes in calcification. Calcium and fibrosis differentiated by the fact that the calcification means calcium is just like bone and ultrasound does not pass through the bone. So we'll see a negative shadowing, a wedge beyond that particular speckle, and nothing in that particular area would be seen. That would be a black hole below this particular segment. So if there is a speck here, there would be a wedge beyond that. We cannot see anything through ultrasound beyond that particular spectrum. So calcium or fibrosis or thinning out is a marker of earlier infarct. So what we would find in your case, the inferior walls, that means basal septum and mid-septum, or basal inferior and mid-inferior, would show thinning out or akinetic and fibrotic. And the apex would be showing akinesia or hypokinesia with preserved thickness and preserved myocardial nature.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. Ashwini here.
Hi, Ashwini. Bataiye.
Sir, regarding GLS, so while calculating GLS or while applying GLS, do we have to take it in all the views or only short axis or
no,
GLS, and it is the average of all the things?
Beta, GLS is something, the name implies longitudinal.
Yes, sir.
It is always done in the long axis, right? Yes. It is not done in the short axis. You cannot have the left ventricular length in the short axis, right? So it is done in the long axis views. And because, as I said, all 16 segments have to be scored, all three long axis views have to be there. That means apical four-chamber view, apical two-chamber view, and apical long axis view, which is the representation of parasympathetic long axis view, right? Sir. Yes. All these three segments, three images are taken. Volume, the endocardial delineation is done, given that matter to the machine, and then the machine tracks the speckles and gives you the GLS in all three, summative way. You have
so we will calculate the average of all the trees, like what we do in Simpsons.
You don't, the machine does.
Okay.
The machine automatically does. You have to give the machine the inputs in the form of image so that it can track the speckles during Sisley and Dicely, all three images. And then you have to delineate the region of interest by giving the margin to the machine and correcting it out. Thereafter, during the Sisley and Dicely, the machine does the calculation itself.
Okay, sir. Fine. And another question. While looking after RC involvement in MI, so do we have to look after the RV functions also, RV systolic functions?
Wonderful. We do. We do. Unfortunately, the RV is more complex. But if you look at, it's a wonderful question, right coronary artery infarct. If it is ostial or proximal, the right ventricle infarct is likely to be happening concomitantly, which would mean the right ventricle is showing wall motion abnormalities. The free wall of the right ventricle is not contracting well, and it would get dilated. The right atrium may be dilated. There may be emergence of low pressure tricuspid regurgitation. But the same thing, we have to look at the right ventricle wall motion abnormality, specifically when we are talking about the right coronary infarct, proximal or distal. And it has a lot of bearing on the outcomes. A right coronary right ventricular infarct or poor right ventricular function is the worst prognostic marker for outcomes after bypass surgery or open heart surgery.
Okay, sir.
So patient with pulmonary embolism also have acontractile right ventricular free wall, but apex is contracted. And how can we know
difference between pulmonary embolism and right ventricular infarct is the right ventricle itself. In pulmonary embolism, the right ventricle has the power to compensate for the overload. So the PA pressure is going to be higher. You understand? So the pulmonary artery pressure, if you look at the tricuspid regurgitation or certain other markers of the pulmonary arterial hypertension, when the TR is not present, maybe pulmonary arterial flow dynamics and all the pulmonary valvular M modes and all. That's not what I'm going to describe today. But once you look at the pulmonary arterial pressures or right ventricular systolic pressure, which is representing into pulmonary arterial pressures, they would be high in PAH or because of pulmonary embolism. The right ventricle would be enlarged. The right ventricular thickness or contractility would not be low. It would be enlarged, but the PA pressures would be high. On the contrary, when we have right ventricular infarct, you may have patchy or complete right ventricular free wall abnormality, low contractility. There may be TR, but the PA pressures are low.
Yes.
Sanjay, may I add something to it?
Yes.
There's a paper in JACE which talks about all this PA pressure by two-dimension strains. If we have a pulmonary embolism, if we do a two-dimension strain of RV, the apical sparing would be present and basal inferior segments could be hypokinetic. On the other hand, in free wall MI, you can find all the segments to be hypokinetic. That's what I said about this. But it's a difficult answer to say to differentiate between pulmonary embolism and acute right ventricular infarct. As Dr. Sanjay Mittal said, that's what this the way at your level you can diagnose in that particular fashion. And second, the ECG would be the most characteristic as far as I think is that the real right answer.
S1, Q3, T3. But you know, I always approve of that fact that an echocardiographer is a clinical echocardiography. You know, it is basically that we are not just technicians. We have to look at the ECG and the patient before we put on the probe. Absolutely right, Dr. Rakesh.
And one of the person who asked, Dr. Ashwini, asked this question possibly. Like somebody was asking, if you have a previous MI and you again develop a chest pain, can we diagnose by echocardiography?
That's okay. No, we cannot.
Yes.
Because a pain may not be cardiac in your region, or pain, even if it is a cardiac in your region, we cannot distinguish ischemia versus infarction. So that is something, but what that Manoj asked, I think, that if the person had inferior, he was very specific, if the inferior wall infarction happened and now this time anterior wall infarction, that means I presume that ECG already is showing those changes. So that's why I was describing the echo findings. I see one of the questions in the chat box. What is the role of GLS in patients undergoing chemotherapy? Very important, because in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, if a person is undergoing chemotherapy and we wait for the systolic dysfunction to set in, it may be too late. And this time, especially the donorubicin, doxorubicin therapies, it may be irreversible. So we have enough of the reason to believe that GLS, if we do early and it detects the drop in the values of the GLS, then at that point in time, we may put the person on corrective or supportive medications and maybe take another factor not to escalate the dose or cumulative dose of doxorubicin and donorubicin to prevent further deterioration of LB functions.
Anybody else would like to ask?
Regarding in continuation with the same question regarding chemotherapy, so many of the patients receiving this doxorubicin, donorubicin, they come with depressed ejection fraction. Mm-hmm. And that is secondary to chemotherapy that they receive. Mm-hmm. So considering their management, is there any role of medications like beta blockers, ACE inhibitors in those patients? Like as we give in the patients who is having ischemic heart disease or other...
It is a complicated issue. You know, it's a Pandora's box, because cardio-oncology is a discipline of its own. It's not only the doxorubicin and the Herceptin, etc. They are also very toxic. Yes. The nature of the toxicity of Herceptin receptor is reversible to some extent.
Yes,
so if they are having concomitantly, both of them actually worsens the chances of a person having LV dysfunction. So a component of doxorubicin-induced myocardial dysfunction could be reversible only to the extent that it was because of Herceptin, not because of the doxorubicin. So doxorubicin-induced myocardial damage is usually irreversible. To answer your question, we have, that is why to detect early, by doing GLS, not wait for the LV systolic function to drop. At that point in time, put them on beta blockers, ACE inhibitors for that matter, to prevent the furthering of the damage to the myocardium.
Okay, so if the dysfunction has already happened, like in case of irreversible damage, there won't be any role of cardiac remodeling drugs.
Yeah. They have to be treated on the lines of HFrEF, heart failure with reduced ejection fraction.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Anybody else? Dr. Aung Koi Kim?
No question, sir.
No question. Dr. Suitant?
I think the question I answered was by Dr. Suitant only.
Okay. Dr. Kin Susan. Dr. Chaw Thuthu.
No questions, sir.
No questions. Dr. Neha, you want to ask something? Anybody?
Hello, sir. Can I ask one question? Go ahead. With regard to this inferior wall, the aneurysm, sometimes we do see in patient with RCA infarction.
Mm-hmm.
To identify or diagnose the aneurysm on the posterior segment or basal inferior segment, sometimes we used to see only basal area, and because we used to see some adjacent segment as well, akinesia or hypokinesia. So I understand in isolated basal segments, is it not always the hypokinetic segment is not always due to ischemia or infarction, is especially we come across when you do a stress echoes. Can you please explain whether if I'm wrong, or how can I go ahead with this?
Okay, so as I said, there is always, whenever there is a solar eclipse, there is an umbra, right, where there is no light reaching there. But there is a zone of penumbra where some light is reaching, but there is, it's still darker than the areas where the full light is reaching. So same thing happens when the coronary arteries are being distributing the blood. There is area which is densely only involved because of that artery's occlusion. And there is area of adjacent or gray zone where the adjacent artery, which was normal, is supplying enough blood to make that particular area just at best hypokinetic. That means more than 70-80% of that myocardium thickness is still alive. So in RC territory, the answer to your question is two ways. In RC territories, if there is an aneurysm of the inferior wall basal segment, is an inferior basal septum, that means the RC territory possibly was the culprit. And the mid segments are basically saved because of the fact from the collateralization from the LAD or the circumflex territory. So that can happen. It may be a small RCA, or there could be a collateralization from the adjacent arteries. So that is one side of the story. If we do a stress test in this situation, because the collaterals are not supplying more than 50% of the myocardial blood supply, they would produce ischemia and they can be showing worsening. On the other hand, there are reasons of having aneurysm in submitral area, which are not of coronary origin. So that is a total different cup of tea altogether. However, whenever you have a reason like this, you have to confirm by checking it out and ruling out the coronary anatomy.
Okay, thank you, sir. Hello.
Yes.
Sir, serial echoes, kab, kitne age mein, kitne baar frequently karna chahiye, yadi patient, kisi normal patient mein. यदि किसी पेशेंट को सीएडी हो चुका है तो उसको फिर कितने कितने टाइम बाद सीक्वेंशियल इकोस करना चाहिए?
कोई जरूरत नहीं है एको को रूटीन पर्सन करने करने के लिए कभी हम एडवाइस नहीं करते हैं जब तक के लिए कोई क्लिनिकल फीचर ना हो. अगर कोई चेस्ट पेन है, ब्रेथलेसनेस है, टू रूल आउट हार्ट डिजीज, यस. अगर आपको मरमर मिल रही है, यस. सो यू हैव टू, यू कैन नॉट डू एकोकार्डियोग्राम्स इन एवरी पर्सन unless you are incorporating that as a health package thing after clinical evaluation. Second thing is, in a person who you already have diagnosed as a disease, cardiac disease, valvular or coronary disease, you in valvular disease, you have to do it on a regular basis. After valve replacements also, we do it annually, or whenever a person complains of change of symptoms, fever, to rule out infective endocarditis or breathlessness or some ECG abnormalities, something of that sort. If you have some new development, yes, at that particular point in time, or if you have a routine evaluation of valvular cases every year, what we recommend. Certain diseases of valves which are waiting for surgery, they're not yet categorized for a surgical candidate, say, for example, moderate MR, or moderate aortic stenosis, or severe aortic stenosis, which is not fitting into the recommendation for surgery as of now, we may have to require to do an echocardiogram to just watch the increase every 3 to 6 months. So there are certain gray zones. It is individualized. As far as coronary artery disease is concerned, I would say that I recommend echocardiogram on a person who has existing left ventricular systolic dysfunction to be done every 6 months. If a person has had revascularization with systolic dysfunction every year, if the person has preserved ventricular function, no symptoms and revascularization and other things, only if the symptoms appear. Or sometimes when we do a stress echocardiogram, we can do that echocardiogram. So it's not something we should be recommending everybody at a frequent intervals.
Thank you, sir.
That good evening, sir.
Patient with atrial fibrillation and it's difficult to see the RWMA.
No, I don't think so. The regional wall motion abnormality is a misnomer itself. We should not at all look at motion. We should look at thickening. And once we look at the thickening, systolic thickening, we would not commit any mistake in any kind of arrhythmias. Ravindra, you were asking something.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. Good evening. Sir, we can detect any stent thrombosis in echo changes, in 2D echo.
Yes, the stent thrombosis would produce wall motion abnormality if it is producing ischemia, right? Yes. Obviously, yes. The way you have described stent thrombosis, that means either it is leading to infarction or it is leading to ischemia. The question comes whether the stenting was done in previously infarcted territory, then it may be a difficult proposition. Again, as I was describing for inferior wall, anterior wall, there could be some catch. If you had a previous echocardiogram where scar was there and now you have a fresh wall motion abnormalities, which are abiding with the territory of that particular coronary artery which was stented, this could be a pickup of ischemia or infarction, which may be a result of the stent thrombosis.
Yes, sir. Sir, is there any... in the early stent thrombosis and delayed stent thrombosis, already patient is in the ICU, we have done stenting and within 1 or 2 days, there is a development of stent thrombosis, we can diagnose by echo.
Now, very important, 80% of the stenting processes which are being done in our country are actually in indications when they are not indicated. In stable coronary artery disease, it's been time and again proven that angioplasties and revascularization does not help against the medical therapy. But majority of the people are doing stentings and angioplasties for stable coronary artery disease, right?
Yes, sir.
That is the commonest reason. In that situation, obviously, a new wall motion abnormality in the area where the stenting was given is important, whether it is in a few hours or a few days, doesn't matter. But in people who presented with acute coronary syndrome and primary angioplasty was done, it may be a difficult proposition because stunning and hibernation, both of the things can be actually complicating the issues. You may have, despite an open artery after an acute occlusion or acute revascularization in acute coronary syndrome, a persistent wall motion abnormalities for a few hours to few days, which is called as stenting. So yes, that's why acute stent rethrombosis may be difficult to pick up in people who actually were subjected to primary angioplasty. However, there could be people who were subjected to primary angioplasty, they improved the contractility and now they show a deterioration along with symptoms and ECG changes, then again it's a precursor or a diagnostic factor for stent thrombosis.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, one question.
Yes.
Sir, during acute myocardial infarction, we done the echo, then reduced ejection fraction, ECG changes. After a few hours, few days later, ECG become normal after thrombolysis, all these things. So, sir, wo sir, contractility us time pe reduce thi, wo baad mein normalize bhi ho jati hai, ya fir kuch rehta hai, sir?
Yes, normalize ho sakti hai. Sometimes the ECG changes, jo kai baar ECG changes khatam ho jayenge, lekin kuch areas mein chota mota reh sakta hai. लेकिन ये आपकी बात बिल्कुल सही है कि अगर ECG कंप्लीटली नॉर्मल हो गया है तो बहुत लाइकली है कि इस हार्ट का जो कंट्रैक्टिलिटी है वो भी नॉर्मल हो जाए.
जी सर. जी सर. थैंक यू सर.
सो इफ देयर आर नो मोर क्वेश्चंस डॉक्टर राकेश.
I think let me just pay thanks, Sanjay, for your...
Good evening, sir.
Somebody was asking some question.
Dr. Anil, go ahead.
Sir, can we differentiate between transmural and subendocardial infarction by 2D echo, sir?
Usually not. Perfusion imaging we can, contrast imaging we can. But by just plain and simple echocardiogram, it is very difficult to distinguish between subendocardial and transmural infarction. Yes, I would say that if nearly 80% of the myocardium is alive, that means subendocardial infarction, the contractility at best would be hypokinetic. But if it is transmural, the segment is likely to become akinetic or sometimes dyskinetic. So you can say as I was mentioning to you, hypokinesia, akinesia, dyskinesia, as we increase in that ladder, the amount of myocardial injury is increasing in the transmurality.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, anybody else before we close? Dr. Koi.
I'll have to leave.
All right. Right. Thank you, Sanjay. I'm grateful. This is one topic which keeps on burning all the times in the world. And the most important part is people want to know more and more about coronary artery disease rather than LV systolic function. That's the best part of this particular topic. And I thought nobody else better than you to answer these questions, where you do a lot of practical work and able to answer, somebody was asking subendocardial versus transmural. That's really knowledgeable person trying to ask some of these kind of questions.
Wonderful questions. I enjoyed interacting with all you guys. Thank you. Thank you for asking all those questions. They're wonderful questions, which made me believe that all you guys were hearing what I was saying and possibly trying to understand also. I do not know whether I was able to explain everything to you, clear your doubts, but I tried my best.
I'll say I learned a lot more things from you majority of time. I can say that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you, everybody. And now we close this session and see you next week with diastology. So have an active motion for this week and then we'll relax next week.
Bye. Bye, everybody.
Good night. Bye-bye. Thank you.